Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined this week by the man with no moniker, Ken Kaiden. Welcome to the show.
Welcome. Dean, thank you very much for having me on the show today. It's been good to actually speak to somebody that's not a work colleague, to be honest with you. It's actually good to have some sort of conversation that's actually about the stuff that I quite enjoyed doing up until March last year.
Yeah, I'm a bit of the same boat. This is kind of my only outside access to humans at the moment, because I've been working from home since March last year. So it's the only time I actually see anyone that's not my mum, my folks, my wife, or her mum. That's it. The only time I get to see other people. Right, so first question, and we'll just spin off as always. How did you get into pro wrestling?
It's a funny one. This is probably a pretty controversial answer, because, you know, most guys in wrestling, I've probably heard it countless times already. I've listened to a few of the episodes, and you kind of get the similar kind of answer all the time, where it's like, you know, I watched wrestling when I was really young, blah blah blah. I've loved wrestling my whole life. I've had a few disagreements in the locker room about how I got into wrestling. I've never really been a lifelong wrestling fan. I watched a little bit when I was young. I remember watching a lot of WWF back on the, I actually can't remember what channel it was on back in the day. I think it was terrestrial TV. I want to say Channel 4, but I don't know if that was a bit later on. But I certainly remember having the 1992 Royal Rumble on VHS, which I watched quite a lot when I was young. So a big fan at the time of like Ric Flair and stuff. But I stopped watching for a long, long time. Around about the time, end of the sort of Bret Hart period, and as we're coming into the Attitude Era, I completely abandoned any semblance of liking wrestling up until actually not that long before I started training. My girlfriend got me back into it because she was a fan. I remember going around to hers and we'd watched a couple of pay-per-views or whatever, and I was like, this is a bit rubbish. And then she kind of introduced me to like Ring of Honor and stuff. And then, yeah, got into Ring of Honor through the sort of technical kind of side of wrestling. Still not a huge, huge fan of like the sort of American style, like main event kind of wrestling. But as anyone who's probably watched any of my matches or spoken to me about wrestling, like I've always been more into the technical side and the sort of athletic side of it. So, got into it through sort of Ring of Honor, maybe about, how long ago would that have been? Maybe 2012, maybe. So, yeah, not actually that long I've been properly watching wrestling again. Try to remember the first pay-per-view I watched. I think it might have been Money in the Bank. Don't think it was the one Dolph won.
I think it was the one with Punk leaving at the end, or
I think it might have been
2011.
Actually, was Dolph 2012?
Now you're asking. Hang on. So, who won the money?
Honestly,
I
can't remember, but yeah, anyway, it's only really been the last sort of 8 years that I've been properly watching wrestling again, And yeah, so I don't really have the same sort of journey as a lot of the guys. I've put my hands up and say I'm not a lifelong wrestling fan. And there are certain eras that I'm not really a big fan of. Another controversial opinion, Attitude Era, not really my kind of scene. Never has been, it never will be, I don't think. But I've got my own opinions of the Attitude Era. But yeah, it's a bit of a different journey from most folk. More recent than certainly most guys you'll find in a backstage locker room.
So just for people that are listening to this going, yes, it was 2012, Dolph Ziggler won.
So it might actually be that one. Because I do remember watching Dolph. I don't remember if he won the match or not, but I do remember watching Dolph in a match and thinking, this guy's actually pretty decent. But yeah, I can't remember. It must have been the same one then. It must have been that Money in the Bank then that I watched. It's crazy, I think, because that doesn't feel like that long ago. But Christ, that's what, coming up for 9 years now.
So that was a fairly lean period, so I can see where you kind of drop out. Because my opinion is, which has changed dramatically. I started watching in 99. It was WWF Heat on Channel 4. So when I was on Channel 4. And from, I don't know, just growing up, I would find the Ruthless Aggression era better than Attitude era, because it was just more fun for me personally.
I'd probably agree with that.
But yeah, trying to restart your love of wrestling in 2011, 2012, unless you've followed CM Punk or anything like that, it's a hard sell.
Oh, well, that's the one. Like, so the reason why I stopped watching wrestling was because of there was a little bit of the reputation, and it's part of the reason why I never really liked the Attitude era. I'm a little bit older than you, so I would have been around about 10 by the time the Attitude era was fully kicking in, 1998, I would have been turning 10. So around that time is when a lot of my friends were really getting into it, and I don't know, I just thought it was really stupid. Like, looking back on it, it is still really stupid. Like, there's a lot of really bad wrestling and a lot of really bad storylines in that era. Obviously, the stuff that was great is obviously what keeps it in people's minds. But I don't know, the Attitude Era for me, I kind of line it up with a sort of Jerry Springer era of that kind of trash TV. So for the longest time, like, I kind of looked at it as trash TV, you know. Like, I stopped watching it because I was like, this is really stupid. And I thought all wrestling was like that. So it was only really when I started, when my girlfriend got me into it again, and we started watching the sort of mid-card guys, so your Dolph Ziggler's, your Daniel Bryan's, your CM Punk's, and, you know, I've always been I've been a really skinny guy as well. I've always been really skinny growing up. I've always had a kind of problems with my weight throughout my childhood and sort of teenage years. So I always dismissed wrestling as just being, you know, a bunch of steroids, really muscly, meaty men, just looking ridiculous. But it was only really when I watched these guys and started to, especially like Money in the Bank's a great pay-per-view for it, because, you know, it really showcases the mid-card guys, the workhorses, if you might want to call them, you know. And obviously watching Ring of Honor, full of those guys as well. Like, Austin Aries was probably one of the first names that kind of drew me back in through Ring of Honor, although I probably wouldn't really watch any Austin Aries matches anymore. But it was watching these kind of matches where I was like, actually, you know what, the smaller guys actually have a really good place in wrestling, and they seem to be getting a lot of sort of TV time at the time, and a good chance to showcase their sort of ability. And that's part of the reason why I decided to start training, is you know, I looked at it and gone, well, these guys aren't that much bigger than me, really. Like, their kayfabe weights and heights are definitely not similar to mine, but like the real life height, like Adam Cole is much smaller than I am. Times the height, he's maybe a bit, obviously a bit more muscular, but there's no real difference between the sort of up and coming guys that you see these days and well, me, you know. Like, there's a lot of like 5'5", 5'6". Look at guys like Pac, like, he's tiny compared to what people expect out of a normal wrestling kind of persona, you know. So
absolutely. Speaking of, well, I've met Pac. I was very lucky to, and he's shorter than me. And I was looking at him going, how are you shorter than me? And then, well, I've met Chavo Guerrero as well. He's my huge in comparison. Yeah. He's like, how, you look tiny on TV, and now you're just like dwarfing me a little bit. So Ring of Honor was kind of your, did TNA also jump in around about then as well?
Yeah, I think I watched a little bit after. I'm trying to get my bearings right with who was where when I started watching. I think Austin Aries was actually in TNA at the time, so he would have been one of the guys that I watched through TNA rather than Ring of Honor. Sorry, I think we watched more TNA back in the day just because it was on Challenge. It was a lot easier to watch. Didn't really want to watch Raw and SmackDown on. Well, we did. I wasn't paying for Sky Sports, so certainly still not paying for BT Sport, I guess it is now. Wouldn't pay the price just to watch Raw and SmackDown. And yeah, TNA was just more accessible. So I watched a lot more of that than WWE. I still don't really watch much WWE, even though I've obviously been wrestling for a few years, really, really into wrestling. But WWE, certainly the main roster at least, is still never really gripped me the same way as other promotions. And it is the other promotions that are what drew me back into wrestling and what actually made me make that push into starting training to actually become a wrestler myself.
Yeah, so that was 2012 when you made your debut. Sorry, 2015. I'm all over the place.
Yes.
Today, so
yeah,
2015 is your debut. So when did you actually start training? What year was that?
It was, I think it was just about a year before. So it wasn't that long after the school opened in Dundee. I actually didn't even realize there was any local wrestling at the time. Like, I'd been watching wrestling for a couple of years by this point, but I actually didn't realize what the local scene was like. I'd obviously watched some of the smaller promotions, but they were the smaller major promotions. So like, I'd watched a bit of New Japan by this point, and then obviously Impact and Ring of Honor, as well as WWE. But I obviously knew about the indie wrestling scene, but I thought it was more an English thing or a Glasgow kind of thing. I'd obviously heard of ICW, but I didn't realize just how many promotions there were just dotted about Scotland. You know, like I'd never heard of like SWE. I'd never heard of Reckless Intent. Excuse me, sorry. I'd never heard of Reckless Intent. I'd never heard of WrestleZone or anything like that. And I think it was actually on a night out in Dundee, I'd seen posters for the DDP show and the Bret Hart show. And it was only when I saw that in a kebab shop at like 3 o'clock in the morning after a night out, I think at Underground or something, or like Fat Sam's or something like that in Dundee, that I even realized that there was actually wrestling in Dundee. And it wasn't that long after the school opened in Dundee, after they moved from Blair Gowrie, that I decided, let's just go along. I never ever intended on actually getting to the point of debuting. At that point, I just remember watching these guys and going, I'd actually just love to just stand in a ring and run the ropes a bit and maybe take a few moves, do a few moves, take a few bumps. So I remember paying, I think I paid a full month, because they did, you could either pay for a month or you could pay per session. And I thought, you know what, I'm going to give this an actual go. I'll pay for a full month. Makes me obligated to actually go to training for a month. If I don't like it, I'll just stop going. If I do like it, you know, we'll keep going. And obviously I just kept going.
So what, did you have a sports background beforehand?
Nope.
You said you struggled with weight. Was that a factor as well?
Never. No. Never. See, you go back to like my high school days and like primary school days and that kind of thing. Like, I think like Dundee's a weird one when it comes to sport, especially in public school. So I went to Morgan Academy in Dundee, and I went to Cluppington Primary beforehand, and they're located very central in Dundee. It's not a very it's a fairly lower class school, you know. I'm not saying this in like a dig to the other people around me, but like the families of my classmates were all very working class as well, and most of them share a love of football. So football is the sport in Dundee, especially in public schools, and certainly the public schools I went to. If you don't like football, you basically don't like sports. So I hate football. I absolutely cannot stand it. You know, it's even worse now. I'm living in Glasgow because I've got obviously the Celtic Rangers kind of rivalries. But even in Dundee, the Dundee United Dundee rivalry, I couldn't hack it. I absolutely hated it. So when I was a school kid, I used to try and get up PE as much as possible, because basically all we did was play football. There's a couple of months where we maybe play hockey or maybe play something else, but I always came back to playing football, and I hated football. So by proxy, I basically hated any kind of sport. So I was very inactive as a child. I never went to the gym, probably actually till I started training, to be honest with you. I spent most of my childhood, and I still do, I guess, playing video games mostly. So yeah, like no real background at all in any sort of sport or physical activity. It was actually one of the reasons why I was hesitant to make that leap into training, because I wasn't fit at all. Like, I knew my cardio was terrible. I was still really skinny. I mean, I still am skinny, but I was even skinnier than I am now. And I didn't know whether or not I should bulk up a little bit first before training, or if it would come just naturally through training. And I decided to just go the route of doing it while I was training. I'm still not particularly, like, I'd say I'm fit. I'm not like the gold standard, far from it, but I'm certainly a lot fitter and a lot healthier probably than I was 10 years ago, you know?
So what was it like taking that first bump then? So you've had no physical activity, you don't have a background in any kind of martial art or anything like that, or no. Used to being thrown to the ground. So how was it getting thrown into the deep end and hitting the ropes and bumping for the first time?
Sore. I think it'll be the same for even if you have a history of being in some sort of sporting capacity, it is sore. Your first bumps are very sore, unless you're like really already trained in taking break falls through some sort of martial art. Bumping is so unnatural to you that, especially for someone like me, it did actually take a while to get used to it. The first few months, like, I would come back with like my elbows would be bruised. I actually remember having to get an x-ray not long after I started, because I think I just took a really bad back bump, and I felt my feeling just went in my arm, and that went through my whole body. I was white as a sheet, and I was like, Christ, this is just terrible. This is like a couple months in and I'm still really struggling to get these back bumps. And I'm not going to say I wouldn't even say now I'm great, but I certainly didn't take to it like a duck to water, you know. Like, I went the hard way through training, you know. I had to kind of force myself to break through that barrier of getting it. Like, it did not come naturally to me at all. You know, I'd see other people come through training that did take to it like a duck to water, you know. Like JD Wilde, for example, he had a little bit of history anyway. I think he did a bit of a Greco-Roman back in the day, and he's always been a active guy anyway. So like watching him come in and, you know, he got back bumps like that, he was able to run the ropes like that, he was taking moves and doing moves like that. So his training before he debuted was a lot shorter than mine. But it was actually probably him coming to training that kind of helped me push through to get to where to the point where we got to actually debut. I would probably say if he didn't start training with me, it would probably have taken me a lot longer to actually get to the point of having a match on a show.
Well, you've segued beautifully into the next bit, which was your debut in 2015 was with JD yeah. Wild. So what were your thoughts going into that first match?
Absolutely bricking it. It came out of nowhere. See, when you're training, you always hear people say to you in the back and at training, and your coaches will say to you, always be ready for it. So like, I was actually quite lucky in the sense that I'd only a few months prior just went and bought my first ring gear, which is just plain black biker shorts, plain black kick pad, knee pad covers and kick pad covers. Just on the off chance, you know, that the day could come at any point. Didn't have a name yet, didn't have music yet, didn't have anything yet, really. I wouldn't have said I was probably ready at the time, but we got the news the morning of the show. It was actually originally meant to be a triple threat, which, if I'm honest, I'm glad it wasn't. I'm glad it was a singles match. It was originally supposed to be a triple threat between myself, JD Wild, and the Riot, Chris James. He ended
up... I knew that was a new name you were going to say. I don't know why. So you said triple threat, I thought, yeah. Riot, Chris James. It's going to be Riot, Chris James, isn't it? Anyway, sorry, interrupt you.
to be honest, you'll probably hate me for saying this, but he did kind of chicken out of it a bit. I think, to be fair to him, he didn't think he was quite ready for it yet. So he he said, thank you for the opportunity, but I'll pass on it for now. So he ended up actually refereeing the match, to be honest with you. But I am glad it wasn't a triple threat, just because, you know, three absolute green as grass guys, never had a match before. A triple threat would have been a disaster. So we got, I think it was a 6-minute match, just myself and JD. I'm glad it happened with him. Like, if there's one person I would have trusted in the ring that day, would have been JD. Like, I trust the guy every day in the ring. You know, we've had plenty of matches now, and there's nobody I trust more than this guy in the ring. And I think we had a decent match. You know, I've not watched it for a while, but especially compared to other debut matches, and especially considering both of us were debuting, I think it was a pretty decent match. You know, it was basic as hell, but you know, it got the job done. We didn't really make any real mistakes, other than, I think, JD, we did the box standard sleep leap into the hip toss. JD went under me, I think, during the leap, tripped over his shoe, and almost went flying out of the ring, which is good to watch back. But other than that, like, we recovered well, and we got from A to B. And to be honest with you, it was actually a really good show. I don't remember any of the rest of the show, but when I say it's a really good show, I mean the crowd were brilliant. It was at the Ardor Complex. We had the balcony open as well. It's probably the most people I've seen in the Ardor Complex for a show. So it was very nerve-wracking because of that, because there was so many people there. We were used to having just the main floor open, and we would usually get changed back on the balcony. But we had the balcony open as well that day, and it was full. So we you know, had a lot of pressure on us. But it was a bit of a funny one. We didn't have a name or anything at the time, so we didn't have any music, so it was literally a case of going up to the music desk and saying, right, what have you got on iTunes? And let's just pick the best song. JD ended up picking the Arctic Monkeys, which he used for a while, actually. I've got a terrible music taste, so I didn't want to pick anything kind of mainstream. So I think I ended up picking, I think it was the Chemical Brothers, Block Rock and Beats, which, thinking back on it, it's a terrible engine song. But I used that for a couple of shows. I think we used that for the first three shows. And that's where the name Kenny Kidd came from. And to be honest with you, I hated the name from the beginning. I always wanted to change it as soon as I came up with it. But it was one of those things where, you know, we had a couple of hours before the show and I needed a name to debut with. So the name actually came from, obviously, Kenny from my real name. But the Kidd part actually came from Jesper Kidd, who is the... he's a composer for various video games. So I think he does Assassin's Creed soundtracks. Is probably what he's most famous for these days. But I really enjoyed it. He used to do like a lot of electronics. I'm a big electronic music fan. He used to do a lot of electronic music soundtracks back in the day. So he's always been a composer I like. So I like the alliteration. Hence why I kept the alliteration for Ken Kaiden. But I hated the name to begin with. As soon as I debuted with it, and I thought back on it and went, obviously the word Kidd is going to think of, one, the goat thing, which got compared to Daniel Bryan a lot, and obviously just made me sound like a child, which, you know, when I debuted, 2015, so I would have been 20, don't even know, I lose track of how old I am. That's like 7 years ago.
I mean, I turned 30 last year, and that's the only way I know, because I know it's a nice round number.
So I would have been 24, 25. So I wasn't young by any debut standards, you know, especially when you're seeing guys debut at the age of like 15, 16, 17. 25, mid 20s isn't a young age to debut. I always hated the name Kenny Kidd, and wanted to change it at the first chance, and I just never ever got the chance. I actually wanted to change it on the first show back after I came back from Australia, but I got kind of talked out of it until obviously I ended up changing a few months later. I think it was like March after I came back. So it was a good 6-7 months after I came back that I changed the name. But it was always on the agenda as soon as I got back from Australia. We needed the name changed ASAP.
So, I mean, for all the faults, and there is many, of Dundee, one thing that you can't not say is the crowd. The crowd want their wrestling and they love their wrestling.
Yeah, I loved the Dundee crowd are fantastic.
I mean, I know myself because I've been to many shows when they're in the Arthur Complex way back when. And yeah, when you said the open balcony, my first thought was like, no, that's where they changed. Because that's what I remember from when I went down there. 2013, 2014 was the last time I went, I think. So yeah, I was at that DDP show as well at the Arthur. They do love the wrestling down in Dundee. But so it's just been there you've been before you went to Australia, or actually back to the first match first. We talked about the physical, the like bumps and all that kind of stuff, first match, bricking it. Are you quite an outspoken person? Was bringing the crowd in, or because it was a Dundee crowd, it was quite easy?
Absolutely not. I'll be honest, it's probably the one thing that I really still struggle with to this day. Like, I'm a very introverted person. You know, I spent my childhood basically in my house playing video games. And this is before the days of Xbox Live and, you know, the PlayStation Network. So this was all, PS1, PS2. You'd had one extra friend around to play video games with, you know. So, like, and a lot of these games I played were, like, single-player games. I'm a big RPG fan. So, like, even to this day, like, mostly I don't really play online games that often. So it was a lot of single-player games, which means a lot of isolation. Even though obviously I did have a good handful of friends growing up, I've never been like that kind of outspoken person. I'm not the kind of person that will go out their way to like get to know someone. Like if I'm in a crowd of people that I've never met before, I'll probably wait till they speak to me before I speak to them. So yeah, as an introverted person, you know, try and get any real connection to the crowd's always been a really tough one for me. I'm the kind of person that thinks the worst probably all the time. So I tend to overthink a lot, which has its ups and downs, but in a wrestling match, it actually has quite a lot of downs because you end up thinking too much and forget almost to, that you've even got a crowd there. I wouldn't say I'm unsuccessful, you know. Like I've obviously ended up with a decent decent following in Dundee, and you know, the places I have worked, I feel like I've done what I needed to do. But for the type of personality I've got and the type of kind of guy I am, like I find it a lot harder than some people. Like I say, JD is a complete polar opposite to me. You know, he'll throw himself into anything head first, sometimes literally, you know. And so he's the kind of guy that, you know, the crowd would, he has the crowd in the palm of his hands within seconds, because he's just that kind of guy. He's very charismatic, and I'm very jealous of it sometimes. So I've like mine and JD's relationship's been one of opposites and sort of yin and yang, you know. So we both bounce off each other, and he brings the best out of me. I'm sure he'll say that I bring the best out of him as well.
We're very similar then, because my growing up in this, my childhood was mainly watching wrestling, going to Saturday Market and buying VHSs, and LimeWire was my friend.
LimeWire,
the virus of many a computer that I've killed over my time. And yes, single player games are just wrestling games, really, SmackDown games and all that kind of stuff. But it's very strange being an introvert doing what you do the wrestling bit, and doing this as well, because I'm more comfortable doing it over Zoom, because once the conversation's over, that's it. I don't have to shuffle. Yeah. Like, I've always thought, once this is over, I might get guests into my studio, and I'm thinking, but no, I'm going to tell them to get out eventually. At least this way I can just go, end meeting, and right. I'm done.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's over. But yeah, that's definitely something we have in common. So you're Kenny Kidd. I think a lot of your matches starting off was with JD.
The first three matches we had were against each other. So we opened, we had like a... They did a thing for a while. We did it a few times and then we stop it and then we maybe try it again and then we kind of leave it. But the whole point of our matches to begin with were they were dark matches. So they were like this, 7 o'clock would be the first bell and we would go out maybe 20 to 7 just to warm the crowd up. And even at 20 to 7, you know, the for the first couple of shows, the crowd was at capacity. You know, the people were already in before the dark match even started. So it wasn't even like we were wrestling in front of half of a hall. You know, we were pretty much wrestling in front of the full crowd. Third match wasn't the dark match. First two were dark matches. I think the third match was mid card. It was back when they did the European tournaments. I think we were a mid-card match on the first night. I think we were supposed to have a fourth match the day after, but I was actually in London that day, so I wasn't on that show. But yeah, we've had loads of matches. I can't actually remember how many matches I've had now. It must be at least 15 to 20. We wrestled quite a lot in the first couple of years, especially on the lead up to our first title reigns back in the end of middle of 2016. Most of our feuds kind of, even though we'd obviously wrestle other people, getting a feud to other people, we'd always end up back with our sights on each other. And it was great. I liked having that rivalry from day one. You know, I'm sure in the future, once we can wrestle again, whenever that will be, whether it be in FCW or any other promotion, the two of us will, I'm sure, we'll get back together and face each other again at some point.
So I was going through your opponents on the old cage match, the Germans putting together the information. Yeah. Although I think possibly most of the information came from us somehow, because I think I was the only place that carried.
I always wondered how you actually submit information, because I've been on my page, a little bit of a vanity thing, just to see how much information gets put on and how accurate it is. And there's been a couple of times I've gone, oh, they've missed a show here, but I could never work out how to actually tell them, oh, by the way, this is a show, here's the card. Have you ever submitted to them yet?
No, but it's always the case where I get the results for not just for those shows, although I seem to be the only place that carried them, so I'm assuming that it came from me. But for other shows, and then an hour later, they appear on Cage Match. I'm like, all right, just give me some credit. I've taken the time to get this information. But yeah, I've no idea how to actually submit to Cage Match. I'd love to, because I have seen mistakes myself and I'm just like, well, no, that's wrong, but I don't know how to tell you that's wrong.
Yeah, I can never work it out.
So yeah, I was going through your list of opponents, and one that kind of a lot of guys you faced were of the company, of Dundee Company. But one that caught my eye was Looking Sharp, because he's very much, I would say, the polar opposite to you in terms of personality and charisma. And he's doing huge things in Europe and everywhere at the moment. So I would say at that point, that was probably one of your more, I would say, big name opponents, because he's things everywhere else. What was it like going into that match, particularly with him?
It was really good. We actually, I'm trying to remember, we weren't originally supposed to have Lou in, because we brought him in during the period throughout 2016, just before I left, where myself, JD, and Stephen Miles had been told, three of you are going to get the Future Division title this year. You guys can basically write yourselves what you're doing with it, how you're doing it, kind of thing. So we had always led up to, we'd written the year basically to lead up to the August show, which was Hell for Lycra, and we always knew we wanted to have a ladder match at that show, and we had toyed with the idea of bringing in an outside guy just to elevate the story a little bit. So yeah, that's essentially how Lou came in. I can't actually remember how his name got brought up. It was definitely between the three of us that we decided to bring him in. I'm trying to remember though. I don't recall JD or Steven actually having a one-on-one match with him. I could be wrong though, but actually, I tell a lie. I'm completely making that up. I'm pretty sure my singles match with Lou came a little bit before then, and it was after that that we decided, oh, let's actually bring him in for our feud later on. I don't remember exactly how the match came about, but I think it was just a case of, you know, we'd been around a little bit now. We were kind of doing pretty well considering the length of time we'd been with the company, and I think we were just. I think JD got another outside guy as well around the same time. So we had just both been given an outside opponent just as a nice wee treat, basically, for what we had done so far. And yeah, like it was really nerve-wracking. Like Lou's a great guy, like a lot of time for the guy. I've worked on with him a couple of times and I've been on a good few shows with him now, and he's a great guy. And yeah, you're absolutely right. Like his charisma is through the roof. It was kind of difficult, but at the same time, it was really easy to work the match because Lou does everything for you. Like you don't really need to worry about getting the crowd behind you because if Lou's working heel, the crowd will hate him, and he will make sure the crowd hates him. So by proxy, the crowd will love you. You know. So I remember not actually doing an awful lot in that match because Lou basically carried the whole thing for us. We did a lot of, I think we had maybe 12 minutes, and I think the first 5 or 6 minutes was just Lou berating the crowd and just doing what Lou does. And it was a good 6-7 minutes maybe before we even locked up. And the rest of the match after that was easy because he had, you know, he got the crowd exactly where he wanted them. And by proxy, I had the crowd where I wanted them without even having to say a word. Like, Lou did all the work for me.
So it's almost your ideal kind of
situation. that is ideal for me. The less work I need to do, the better.
So did you take your break not long after that? After that held for like...
Yeah, so to be honest, it came out of nowhere. I'd always planned on moving to Glasgow. I'd lived in Dundee at that point. Well, 2016 is when I left. So that would be 28 years I would have lived in Dundee. And at that point, I'll be honest, like my 2016, I wasn't in a great place mentally. Towards the end of 2015, 2016, I was really just not great. My mental health was rubbish. Like it was absolutely shot. And my intention was to move to Glasgow, which obviously I eventually did. But I remember being really depressed about the December, January, end of 2015, 2016. And at the time, I just hated where I was in life. I just hated the job I was working. I was working in retail in Dundee, and it was just absolutely soul destroying. I just wasn't getting anywhere that I wanted to be. And I just wasn't happy. So I originally wanted to go to Glasgow, but the more I thought about it, the more I realized it's just a bigger Dundee and it's only an hour away. So I had a couple of guys I worked with, another couple of guys I knew who had done their own traveling, maybe not Australia, but some people went to New Zealand, some people went to other sort of Asian countries, some people just went and did Europe. But a couple of friends went and did Australia, and a couple of mates said I had got plans to go to Australia. And the more I thought about it, I was like, I want to do it. Like I say, I was 28 at the time. And in order to get a working holiday visa, you basically need to do it before you're 30. And I come from I don't want to say poor family, but like my mum was a single mum growing up, myself and my sister. We never really had an awful lot of privileges, you know. Like my mum worked on and off while also going to college, while also trying to, you know, pay our way as well. And I always kind of struggled. That's probably part of the reason why I was quite introverted, and the fact that I didn't really have the money that some of my friends would have had to go out all the time. I certainly never had the holidays that some of my friends had. So I think really by the time I left for Australia, I had had a grand total of 3 holidays abroad in my whole life. 2 of them were to Euro Disney, which was when I was like 5 and 10, you know, so I don't even remember them. Other than them, the only time I say Euro Disney, that's actually showing my age there. Disneyland Paris, I guess it's called now.
Yep.
the only other time I've actually been on a normal holiday, like when I was old enough to really enjoy it, was I went to Bulgaria for a week when I was with my ex-girlfriend. And other than that, it's the only time I've ever been abroad. So like, I spoke to a couple of friends who had been to Australia, and they were talking about, you know, getting a working holiday visa. And I thought, if I move to Glasgow, I'll have to get a job and I'll probably settle. And by the time I'm ready to go do it, if I want to do it in the future, I'll be too old to do it, and I won't be able to get the grant for the visa. So I was like, I'm doing it. So I think it was January, end of January, I decided, right, we're going to Australia. I basically decided it for myself and my girlfriend. She didn't really have much choice, but fortunately she was up for it as well. And yeah, it was quite short notice. You know, we decided on it in January. We needed to save up enough money before we left, which was at the end of August. And yeah, we didn't really give that much notice to the guys in Dundee. I think I pulled them up maybe a couple of months before just to say, I've got news, I'm leaving for a year. But it was fine because it wrapped up the story we were telling. It was myself, JD and Stephen Miles. We were running the future division at the time. And we weren't booking anything other than our own stuff, but we had our own matches, and it was a perfect way for me to end it, because that was the ladder match. It was myself, JD, Stephen, and Looking Sharp, which Stephen ended up winning the title there. And then yeah, I got to say goodbye there for a wee while. But that was a really, really enjoyed. Like, although I say my mental health wasn't great, probably the only thing keeping me going at that point, other than the fact that I was leaving for Australia, was the work I was doing with those guys, because I really, really enjoyed that run. That was when JD got the title for the first time, and around the time I took the title from him, is probably still to this day my favorite match I've ever had. We just had a lot of fun with it.
Being not a big fan going up there, I don't know how much of a title guy you are getting a hold of an actual wrestling belt, but winning that Future Division Championship, which is probably one of my favourite looking belts in Scottish wrestling. It's just because it's Back to the Future, and that's just
yeah.
All good stuff. What was it like winning your first title? Was it euphoric, or was it just like cool?
Yeah, I mean, although I didn't really have the the admiration of wrestling belts that you probably have, you know, I still knew what it meant, you know, and it's a funny one. You try and explain wrestling titles to someone and they go, oh, it doesn't really mean that much though, because, you know, it's all storylines, you know, you're just given it, but, you know, you don't get it unless you deserve it almost, you know? And at that point, you know, I felt like, you know, being told, like I say, myself, JD and Steven got pulled into the locker room at the start of 2016, and that was when we were told, by the way, the 3 of you are going to get a run with the belt this year. And being trusted enough to be able to not only get the belt, but also to write how I got the belt, you know, it was good. It was, I don't know if euphoric's quite the word, but it was, you know, it made you feel like you had accomplished something, you know, and it finally gave you kind of validation. Although I'm not really a title guy. Like, the way I like my wrestling stories doesn't really involve titles very often. But you know, that doesn't mean I don't appreciate the fact that being given a title is a really good reward, regardless of what promotion you earn it in. So it was good, and it was great know that you were trusted enough that you were going to, at least for a while, because I only had the belt the first time around for about a month and a half before I dropped it to Stephen. I actually dropped it to Lou technically, because I lost it in the gauntlet match a couple of months before Lycra. I technically lost it to JD, but Lou ended up with the belt at the end of the match, whatever. The fact that I, until that point where I lost it, you know, I was the face of the division, and you know, it's a good feeling to know that the work you're putting in is being recognized.
So going to Australia, I noticed again on your cage match that you've got a couple matches in MCW down in Australia. So
yeah,
how was that set up? It was just you got there, sent your CV somewhere locally, or did you get a bit of an itch to do some wrestling?
I mean, to be honest with you, like I say, part of the reason, well, the main reason I left to go to Australia was to kind of try and find a bit more happiness in my personal life. So I never went over with the intention of making it a wrestling trip. But I obviously took my gear with me. I took everything with me just on the off chance I could do something. And I was really fortunate. Where we lived, I lived in South Melbourne. And there was a school not that far away from me. It was actually about a 20-minute walk. It was actually really close considering how far a lot of people, even in Scotland, travel to a wrestling school. I did, before I left for Melbourne, I you know, got in touch with a few local promotions, try to send my CV around. It's like any job, you know, you end up just not hearing back from anywhere. And, you know, there was no reason for them to get back in touch with me. Like, I was a complete no-name, especially in Australian wrestling, where, you know, in Dundee, I'd only really wrestled in Dundee. In Scotland, I'd only really wrestled in Dundee and a couple of matches elsewhere. But I was mostly a Dundee guy, a one-promotion guy. And even Scotland, I wasn't well-known. So I certainly wasn't well-known in Australia. So I wasn't anticipating getting any sort of response. But there was a school which I got in touch with, who had me come in for a wee, I wasn't really an interview. I tried. I basically bypassed their beginner process, because they wanted people to have a proper. There was like a 6 to 8 week beginners class that they wanted everyone through the door to do. But obviously, because I'd had training, I'd wrestled elsewhere, I came in, had a wee sit down with the coach, and had he put me. He actually, it's probably the only time I've ever been. Actually, I did spew. He had me come in for a wee session by myself on a Sunday in 35 degree heat. You know, it was middle of summer, or it was coming into summer anyway, in sort of October time in Melbourne. And it was. I've never trained in heat quite like it before or since. And he really, really made me work to get a spot in his classes. Coach is a guy called Carlo Cannon, who. I cannot say a bad word against the guy. Like, the guy is, he's, although I only knew him in Melbourne for maybe like what, 9 months, you know, I would trust the guy with my whole life. Like, the guy, the guy was trained, he's trained by Lance Storm, and I think originally Peyton Royce was one of the trainers at the school as well, obviously before she signed with WWE. So, you know, he's got good connections as well, and his training's fantastic. Like, he's probably my favorite coach I've ever worked under, because he's probably the most passionate man I've ever met in a wrestling school, and the guy would do anything for you. But I trained with him for a while, and although they weren't part of MCW, a lot of the guys that trained with us at Vicious Pursuit would wrestle for MCW. So I'd been along to a couple of MCW shows. To be honest with you, I didn't get as much of a chance to wrestle as I wanted. There was a couple of shows I wanted to do. They had like a sort of Royal Rumble show that they had planned, I think, in the January, which I was supposed to be working, but they ended up postponing it, I think, until... It was actually the month after I left Melbourne, which was really bad timing. So I didn't really work any of their main shows, but I did work a few other gala style shows. I think the ones on Cage Match would have been the St. Kilda Fest. So I got to work with a few of their guys, and I some of the guys that were on those shows anyway, I'd trained with and worked matches with anyway at training. So they weren't like new faces to me. Like I'd known them enough at this point to know who they were, and know what their style was. But it was still amazing, you know. Just although I didn't wrestle anywhere near as much as I would have liked, you know, I certainly wasn't like DCT, who actually ended up. Vicious Pursuit is actually the same school that DCT coached for while he was in Melbourne. But I didn't intend on wrestling while I was over. I didn't plan on it anyway. I did hope that I would get a few matches. I didn't have as many matches as I would have liked, but the experience is still absolutely amazing. Like I say, I'm still in touch with a lot of the guys. Carlo especially. Carlo's amazing. He was one of the first guys when lockdown started to actually do like online classes. So it was actually fantastic. So I've texted him and emailed him or spoke to him on Messenger or whatever a few times over the years, but I've never actually spoken to him again. I've never seen his face outside of like Instagram stories and what he posts online. So when he started doing the online classes, he was like, come on to the classes and, you know, speak to the guys again. It was for those first couple of months of lockdown, I would log in. I should have been working. So I hope none of the guys in my work see this, but I'd log in at 9 o'clock. He'd have because of the time difference, it would be like 7 o'clock there in Melbourne. It would be like 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock here in the morning. And while I had my work laptop open, I would have his classes on Zoom. And those couple of months were amazing. Like I properly fell in love with wrestling again, almost, even though I wasn't able to physically train, just having Carlo on the other end of the Zoom call and seeing the guys I trained with back in Melbourne. It was absolutely amazing for a couple of months. I ended up being so busy with work that I couldn't, he still does them to this day, the online classes, but I've just been so busy with my day job that I've just not been able to get on them. But yeah, I owe a lot to Carlo. He ended up kind of taking me in for a couple of weeks before I left Melbourne. Our flatmate in Melbourne was a bit of a nightmare. She'd stay up till like 5 a.m, 6 a.m, you know, blaring loud music, whatever, to the point where we just couldn't sleep. And we ended up leaving our flat a good couple of weeks before we left Melbourne. And we ended up just living in a wee room in his wrestling school. He didn't make us pay for it at all. He was absolutely happy to just give us a place to stay for a couple of weeks. And he's just that kind of guy. Like he does it because he loves it. He obviously charges for training or whatever, but you know, he would rather someone was happy and they were getting the training and they were getting what they want out of training. The money side of things completely different, completely secondary, even though it is his job. He would rather be a little bit of debt and give the guys the best training experiences that he can give them than have guys not be able to train because they can't afford it. So I do miss the guy. I obviously there's a lot of good training schools in the UK, but if I could train anywhere again, I'd love to be back in Melbourne training under him.
So that's quite a journey then yourself mentally, from starting in 2014, being quite the introvert, not wanting to be the last person to speak to in a group kind of thing.
Yeah.
To put yourself out there, total foreign country, nobody you know, and then just get, was that good for your own kind of, drive or your own mental health, kind of being able to push yourself to do that?
Yeah, like I find it's difficult even in Scotland, like, although I did most of my training in Dundee, before I went to Melbourne, I went down to Source a couple of times. I went down to Reckless a couple of times. And, you know, I knew a couple of guys from there anyway, because they'd wrestle in Dundee or they'd come up. But I always find it so nerve-wracking going to a brand new school or a new promotion, because you're the newbie. And especially if you've got, like, I hate the pressure, and I hate the fact that, you know, when you walk into a wrestling school for the first time and you go, oh, I've trained here and I've trained there and, you know, I can wrestle, you know, I feel like everyone's judging you. And wrestling's a funny one because it's like everyone at training school is usually like a family, but it's almost like when someone new comes into the family, like you say, it's like a prove it. You've got to kind of prove yourself that you're fit to be part of that family. So it's, I find that really difficult. But you know, when I went to some schools I think are a lot more difficult with it than others, but going to Melbourne and it was actually the most nerve-wracking part of it was like I say that the first training session I had with Carlo, it was just me and him, and he basically put me through my paces. He made me do ridiculous drills and basically asked so much of me just to basically see how much he can push me, to see how much I could do. And the most nerve-wracking part of it was, you know, halfway through I'm gassed out my nut, I can barely stand up, I was literally spewing, and you know, the rest of the guys are coming in for the 2 p.m. class and they're all just sitting watching me while they wait for their class to start. And obviously at this point I'd never met any of them, so I don't know which ones are trainees, I don't know which ones are roster guys. I'd obviously never really seen any wrestling shows in Australia at that point, so I didn't know who the roster was, or who the names were again in Australian wrestling at that point. So the fact that you're getting, you know, your ass kicked basically in the ring by your trainer, and you've got all these guys with their eyes on you. Once you get past that, the rest of it was easy. And then Carlo's school especially, like I've never met a bunch of guys who are so welcoming. After that first day, you know, you'd go to classes. It doesn't matter if you were a brand new guy, they'd only had one match, one training session, or if you had been training for like 10, 15 years and had 500 matches under your belt, you know, you got treated exactly the same. And everyone was out for each other. You know, one thing I do find a lot in wrestling is there are some people that are willing to kind of throw you under the bus if it means that it'll help them out a little bit. And I didn't find that at all at Carlo's school at Vicious Pursuit. Like I felt like it's probably the most I've seen. You see the phrase family thrown around a lot, but that like Vicious Pursuit and Carlo's school is the one school I've seen that actually 100% fits that name of family. You know, they all really look out for each other there. On you go, sorry.
No, on you go. No, I was just a gap there, but no, you continue.
I was just about to say, you know, so after I came back, you know, it really boosts my confidence knowing that there's a school like that is happy to accept you. So, you know, it makes it a lot easier in the future. Don't get me wrong, like it's still difficult. And if I was to go down to a brand new school today, I'll probably still feel nervous because, one, I've not wrestled in a year and a half now. Oh, no, sorry, a year. But also, you kind of feel like you've got a lot of eyes on you and a lot of people looking for you to fail. People hope that you fail. I've noticed that a lot in wrestling. But you eventually get a thick skin over it and, you know, you get a lot of criticisms that come your way. And I feel like in the last few years, you know, I've certainly learned how to deal with those criticisms.
So that gave you a lot more confidence to kind of spread your horizons once you came back from Australia, because you said your places and what have you, but I think, again, I'm just based on all the information from the Germans. You appeared in a few more companies following your return, so a bit more matches on Source that were a bit more Source shows as well. So did that experience just let you go, right, okay, I can just try and go other places and see how it goes?
Yeah, I mean, I'll be honest, like it's I've not been as many places as I would like, partially because of the fact that, you know, wrestling's pretty much been on hold for the last year. And, you know, because I started wrestling a lot later than some, and because wrestling's never been my lifelong kind of thing, I knew even when I started training, if I ever do get on a show, I'm never going to make it my career, you know? So like, as much as I love doing shows, as much as I love training, as much as I love wrestling, it's always been second to the rest of my life almost, you know? So although when I got back, I had a renewed love for it and I really wanted to get back in the swing of things, my main priority when I got back to the UK from Australia was, you know, getting my feet back on the ground, because I essentially ran out of money. I knew it was coming back when I was coming back. I didn't come back because I'd ran out of money, but my intention was when I came back to move to Glasgow a lot sooner than I did, because I ended up staying in Dundee again for a full year before I ended up moving down to Glasgow permanently. So my biggest concern at that point was having enough money to survive a year in Dundee. So I needed a new job. I was staying with my mom at that point, and I also needed enough money to be able to then move to Glasgow, which was actually a lot more difficult than I expected, because it's a lot more difficult than you think it might be to find a job in another city while you're still working in that first job. So I ended up having to quit my job while I was working in Dundee, and just move to Glasgow and just hope for the best and find a job while I was there. Fortunately, it didn't take me that long. But I moved between a couple of jobs before I ended up in the job I'm in now. So I'm more stable now, but that was only, I would say I was only stable by, you know, the start of 2019. So I only really had a year to expand my horizons, I guess, before obviously lockdown hit, COVID, whatever, and the wrestling industry stopped. So I didn't have as much of a chance to go elsewhere than I would have liked. But I'm very glad of the opportunities I got before lockdown. And once everything kind of goes up and running again, I'm in a better position now where I probably will look to try and work a few other places. Although, you know, I am, you know, 32 now. I'm going to be 33 this year. I don't know when shows are going to start again. I'll probably be 33 by the time I step foot in a wrestling ring again. So as much as I would love to expand my horizons as much as possible, I actually have no idea how long I'm going to end up wrestling for before I call it in, you know?
Yeah, that's the weirdest thing about this whole thing. It's for one reason or another, there won't be people that were wrestling won't be back. Come
absolutely.
When the shows begin. Like I say, for a plethora of reasons. There's a fancy word to use on a podcast. But yeah, so... Yeah, it's just strange. But you do have a match scheduled for whenever that may be. Yes. So we'll speak about... So you have matches in Source Wrestling. You said Reckless before you went away as well. But Fair City Wrestling is the company that you're kind of not attached to, but you've made a few appearances at their shows, including their first one, even though you were a last-minute replacement for Zach Leon. Who has questions, we'll get to. In a match which I was looking forward to, I watched it on their on-demand, yourself versus Aspen Faith. For anyone who's listening to this, or anyone that knows me, they know I'm a fan of Aspen Faith, so it's always going to be a winner anyway. So what was it like getting thrown, just as a last-minute replacement into this new venture, this new company against Aspen?
It was pretty damn awesome, to be honest with you. Like Aspen's a guy I've really enjoyed watching for a few years as well. I've never actually saw him live before, although I did work a source show with him not that long before. But I've never watched him live, but I've watched a few enough of his matches on YouTube and whatever to really enjoy his work. And I knew this is probably the biggest match, it is the biggest match I've had probably so far. And it was great. I actually wasn't sure if I was even going to be doing that Fair City Wrestling show to begin with. I was originally meant to be in the sixth man. I can't remember if it was an elimination match or if it was just like a six-pack challenge.
It was elimination.
Was it elimination?
Yeah.
I was originally supposed to be in that, but even that wasn't kind of confirmed until... actually only probably about a week before Zach pulled out. But Zach obviously got announced for the match originally with Aspen, and I couldn't be happier for the guy. You know, like Zach's a guy who is another person who I have absolutely no bad word to say about. He's one of the most hardworking guys I've ever seen. Like he's done a lot in the last few years to really prove his place in Scottish wrestling. And I think he's still got a lot to prove. But I was so happy to when see, I think he actually told me before the match was announced, he IM'd me to let me know he was getting Aspen, and I was over the moon for him. I'll admit there was a little bit of envy there where I was like, oh man, that'd be awesome to wrestle Aspen one day as well. So it was good that I say good. It was obviously a shame for Zach that he ended up having to pull out. Although he did obviously get the match with Aspen eventually a couple months later. So it kind of worked out pretty well for both of us in the end. But last minute replacement for Zach in that the very first match. And that was probably, other than maybe the women's match, I'd say my match with Aspen was like the marquee match at that point. I always feel we're wrestling. The day I stop getting nervous before a match is the day I'll probably retire. And I was nervous as hell before that, you know, brand new promotion, very first show, marquee match against someone with as much acclaim and such a huge fan base as Aspen. I was like, this is going to be tough. But Aspen's a guy, like, he's very good at helping you, and he's very good at teaching you. Like, I learned a lot through that match with Aspen. I learned a lot from Sammy that day as well, Sammy Jane. She was obviously backstage on the main event. And she had watched the match afterwards, and the two of us, myself, Sammy, and Aspen sat afterwards to kind of go over the match. And I learned a lot from the two of them. But the match itself, going into it, I was a nervous wreck. It's a funny one with wrestling as well, because I'm a nervous wreck probably before most shows, up until the moment I step through the curtain, and it's completely different. Like, the nerves go away, and it's a lot easier, especially in the last few years. Maybe not in the first couple of years, where you're still really getting to grips with the whole wrestling thing. But once you're comfortable enough to work a match yourself, you start to learn to really enjoy it. And I only really enjoy it while I'm out there. Like the day of the show, before the show starts, I'll admit I'm not very approachable at any show prior to the show starting, because I'm like I said earlier, I overthink things, and I tend to overthink my matches a lot, and I tend to overthink the perception of what could happen or what could go wrong in the match. So I tend to spend a lot of time by myself on show days just contemplating the match, I guess. But I did a lot of that on the Fair City show. But like I say, as soon as I'm out the curtain, it's completely different. And it wasn't a perfect match, not by a long shot. There was a couple of bits I'm not happy with, but it was a really, really good fun match. And I learned enough from him that I feel like if we had another match down the line again, I feel like it would be even more improved. But it's still one of the matches I really, really enjoyed the most.
And I suppose the advantage of it as well, because it was run by John and yeah, Kevin, that they had this kind of hybrid of fans that had the ones from Dundee, because a lot of the guys were on that show. And because it's quite central between that and Aberdeen, you got some from the Aberdeen crowd as well, because of course they would know Aspen and Sammy and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. So I think I may have said to John, but it's a nice middle ground where as matches you never thought you'd ever see because of outside things.
Yeah, yeah.
And now you're actually getting to see them. Because I never would have thought, outside of when you started appearing at Source, I would have never thought I would have seen Ken Kaiden against Aspen Faith, because they don't run in the same circles of promotions. So it's a great way to actually see these matches now. And when the shows return, whenever that may be, you're in the final of the Junior Heavyweight title tournament for FCW against Tommy Cross. So Tommy Cross, he again primarily worked in Dundee and in Fair City Wrestling as well as this kind of creepy character. What are your thoughts going into that match whenever it happens?
Whenever it happens. I mean, at the moment it's scheduled for April. I'll be completely honest, I don't see that happening in April. Obviously, we're basically where we were last March, so I think we're still a long way away from ever being in a wrestling ring again, even to train, let alone in a ring in front of a crowd, you know? So I really don't know when that match will ever be. I won't be surprised if it's not till next year, just with the way things are going. I'm pretty pessimistic that way. But it's a match that I've been kind of wanting for a while. Like Tommy is a guy that obviously, like you said, worked a lot in Dundee beforehand, and you know, he's basically been taken under the wing of JD. So JD's taught him a lot, and Tommy's really come out of his shell. I didn't really know him that well. I still don't really, to be honest with you, because he only came around about the time I left. And we've never really crossed paths up until the last Dundee show. Well, it was actually four for show, where we had we were the last two in the Fast Track Rumble match. But before that, we've never crossed paths at all. So I've yet to be in the ring with them, even to train with them. But I know JD's spent a lot of time with them. He's obviously spent a lot of time with the character, and the whole gimmick that they've got with the cleansing. It's been a proper passion project with JD and Tommy. So I'm really looking forward to seeing almost what I would consider like the finished result. Like, I feel like Tommy at the moment, Tommy's still new enough that I don't want to say the word green, but he's new enough where like he hasn't had a lot of big opportunities yet. And I feel like by being with JD, Tommy's now in a position where he is ready for those opportunities. So I'm to be probably his first match back, I consider that quite a good honor to be the first guy to kind of, I don't want to say prove his worth, but you know, I feel like for Tommy, I'm probably one of his first big matches, and I'm happy to be in that position. So I'm really hoping that I can see what JD's taught him and see what he's been taught from other places, and I'm just really looking forward to seeing what kind of match we can work.
It's very poetic that your first match was with JD, and yeah, when you come back, hopefully your first match will be with his student.
His protege, yeah.
Yeah, his protege. So it's kind of a nice twist on things. So we'll move on. We'll get into some of the fan questions. We'll speak a little bit about Zach Leon as well, because he was your last, it was your last big feud Dundee and that before shows ended and everything else from that point forward. What was it like getting to work with Zach? You've praised him previously in our chat, but what was it like getting to work with Zach?
Mine and Zach's relationship is a very bizarre one. So like, it's funny how the world works in this kind of way. So I've known Zach for a long time. Back when I was in high school, he used to go out with one of my friends for a couple of years. I'm actually not too sure how long they were out with, like in a relationship for, but I met Zach because he was going out with one of my friends, and back when I was 18, so this would be what, 2006. We were part of that same sort of friend circle. So, but like maybe 2004, 2006, I spent quite a lot of time with Zach. But then, as life tends to do, we ended up going different paths. He ended up doing his own thing. I did my own thing, and we ended up not really speaking for years. Now, Zach only started training after I'd left for Australia. And this is probably the story of how I came back as well, actually. So we'll kind of cross off two stories with one here. So it was back when I was in Australia, and I didn't know Zach at this point. I knew the name because I still kind of kept in touch, obviously, with folk from Dundee, and people would ask me on occasion for advice on whatever storylines were happening, and ask me what I thought of this, whatever. And I knew there were some new trainees, so I'd been told about the likes of like Jack Morris, Alex Webb, and Zach Leon. And so I didn't know anything about these guys other than their names. I'd maybe seen a couple of clips of like Jack Morris before I came back, but I didn't know anything about Zach. And it was a couple months before I left, before I came back to the UK, and I pitched an idea. I was like, I'm going to be back in Dundee for the August show. So it was Hellbound. It was a show before Hell for Lycra. I was like, I'm going to be back in Dundee for this time. What can we do? What can we do to bring me back? And I was told, oh, there's a storyline happening with Alex Webb and Zach Leon. They're two new guys. They're friends. They're about to kind of turn on each other. And Alex is going to associate himself with Felix Fortune. So we're like, right, we'll set up a match so that, you know, it'll be Alex and Felix versus Zach. And we'll have a wee thing on the night where Zach's going to be looking for a tag team partner. And it's going to be one of those kind of ones where it's like, if he doesn't find a tag team partner by the main event or whatever, he's going to be in a handicap match with the two of them. So I spoke a lot with Felix at this time. We had kind of sorted out the whole story. And he was the one that told me, oh yeah, you're going to be tagging with this guy, Zach Leon. So it was only at that point, which is maybe a month or so before I came back, that I kind of thought, okay, let's actually look up who this Zach Leon guy is. And it was only when I saw him, I was like, oh my God. Like, I've not seen this guy in like 10 years. And I don't think he realized who I was until the day of the show either. And it was, he actually didn't even know who I was until I came back to the venue. And I didn't even come to the venue until just before our match started. Because I wanted to keep it as much of a surprise as possible. So I worked everyone. And it's probably, that night is by far my favorite moment in wrestling so far. The day I came back, because like I say, I worked everyone. No one knew I was coming back. There was like three people that knew I was coming back. JD Wild, Felix Fortune, and Dave, the promoter, Braveheart. They were the only people that knew I was coming back. And I'd set it up so that we worked out what the match was going to be earlier in the day. Alex Webb and Felix Fortune actually came down to my mum's, and we wrote the match in my mum's back garden. Zach was actually working his day job at that time, so I didn't actually see Zach until I turned up at the venue. And I only turned up at the venue, like I say, about 5 minutes before I came out, because I wanted to kind of show up at the venue just before the match. And surprise everyone. I was actually back in Dundee for about 2 weeks at that time. And I basically isolated myself in my mum's flat for the full 2 weeks. I didn't want to leave the house because I didn't want anyone to see I was back. I didn't post anything on social media. Although actually, I think I kind of worked a little bit, because I went down to Marty Jones's school down in Manchester for a week. So I think I maybe implied I was still down there. But yeah, no one knew I was back. So I remember getting to the venue, seeing Zach for the first time, and Zach was like, oh my God, how are you doing? And it was only at that point that we realized exactly who each other was. And we ended up obviously having the match, and we've been really, really, really good friends again since. But that show coming back was actually, it was so nerve-wracking. I remember standing backstage, and obviously no one knew I was coming back, so no one was expecting me to come through the curtain. So there was a couple of promos throughout the show. On the screen, you see Zach speaking to whoever, saying, oh, do you want to be my tag partner for the night? And they'd be like, nah, go find someone else. And I remember standing backstage behind the curtain, my music lined up, and Zach's out in the ring with Alex and Felix. They're just about to announce the match, and he's like, "Oh, I found a tag partner." You know, he's doing the whole milking it kind of thing, and the whole crowd starts chanting for Eddie Devine. So he was over as hell at this point. And I remember standing backstage and all I can hear is Eddie. And I was like, oh my God, my music's going to hit. I'm going to walk through the curtain and everyone's going to be like, that's not who we wanted. And at the same time, I was like, it's been a year. Like, a year is a long time in wrestling. I've been away for a year. Obviously, like the regular fans who have been coming for years will remember me, but there's probably a good number of fans who never even heard of me before. I was like, what happens if my music hits and no one cares? And so I was absolutely crapping myself. I was like, this is going to be either the best thing ever or the worst thing ever. As soon as the crowd started chanting for Eddie, I was like, this is going to be the worst return ever. It's going to be a total waste of time. My music hit and I've never had a crowd reaction like that in my life, honestly. Like, the crowd went absolutely mental for me coming back. And I actually remember coming through the curtain, standing on the stage before coming down to the ring, and I had the biggest smile on my face. I was actually so happy at that point, I started to cry. And I'm actually really gutted because I've never seen the footage of that show, and I never will. At least I don't think I ever will. So if anyone who is watching this or listening to this podcast was at that show and has like fan cam footage or whatever of my return, please send it over because I'd love to see it. I've never seen it again since, but yeah, so that was the match. We ended up having a really good match back. I did absolutely nothing in the match. I think I did the hot tag, did a couple of moves, pinned Felix Fortune, and that was it. But it was one of the most fun matches I've ever had. I remember actually listening to your podcast. I listened to it a couple of days ago, the podcast with Kuma. And you were talking about how important moments are in wrestling, and you're probably the kind of person that prefers moments in wrestling rather than good wrestling matches. I'm probably the opposite. I'm someone that likes a lot more long form storytelling, and I love really technical matches that tell a story that way. But that match is the best match I've ever had from a moment perspective. Like, the match was not anything special. Like, I literally did nothing in that match apart from stand on the apron, get the hot tag, quick comeback, hit my finish, and that was all I did. And it is probably the biggest crowd reaction I've ever heard in my life. So, like, I completely understand why people prefer that moment kind of thing. It's not my cup of tea usually, but yeah, that was an amazing experience. But anyway, that obviously set in motion stuff with Zach. So it was when I started booking the future division that I started to think about having a feud with Zach. We'd kind of toyed the idea. He wanted to turn heel for a long time, and we discussed, well, why don't we turn heel? Why don't you turn heel on me? I say I was booking the future division. I was booking the future division tournament we had back in 2018, or that started in 2018. The only reason I booked it was because I was told I was winning it, basically. Well, actually, it was supposed to be between either myself or Spike Tierney. Both of us were meant to co-book the tournament, but I pretty much did all of it myself, to be honest with you. And I ended up obviously winning it, but I've been working with Zach since the start of that tournament. So Zach turned heel at Lycra, which would have been, I can't remember if it was August or September that year, and the tournament started in November before. And the storyline for turning Zach heel started at the start of the tournament. So this is actually comes back to what I was saying earlier, where I really prefer that sort of long-term storytelling. Like, I'm not a huge fan. Like, I feel like it's really lazy when, like, if Zach turned to me and said, oh, I want to turn heel, it's really easy for me to go, right, okay, you're going to be in this match as the babyface, and at the end of it you're going to turn on them and hit them with a chair and you're going to berate the crowd, you know?
Oh yeah, I mean, the long form story makes the moments all the sweeter. But yeah, continue.
I feel like that, obviously it can be done really well, and that it has been done really well in the past, but I feel like it's really lazy storytelling to just be like, cool, I'm heel now. I really like to plant the seed. So myself and Zach wrote the storyline from this conception back at the start of that tournament right through to his turning heel. It's probably my favorite thing I've worked on because it worked pretty much perfectly. We planted the seeds where we wanted it to, and it's one of these ones where, like, I find I don't really read too many dirt sheets, and I don't really pay attention that much to, like, the forums, like wrestling forums, whatever. But I'll go on, like, Reddit. I'll go on Square Circle every now and then and see what's happening. I mostly go on it just to keep updated with, like, WWE, because I don't really watch it myself. I go on it to see if anything major's happened, and I'll maybe jump into the comments and see what folk are saying. And you know, you look at any comments, and the first thing, oh, this babyface is really good. You know, it'd be even better, let's turn him heel. And, you know, it's a cop-out to get anyone over, you know, like, oh, let's turn him heel. But I actually can't remember what I was about to say.
So planting the seeds was exactly on, and
oh, that's exactly what I was about to say. Yeah, so like another thing you'll find as well is, like, if you're looking like a pre-show, like let's say it's a pay-per-view today, you're looking like the pre-show thread and Reddit, and people are like, oh, what's going to happen? This is what I want to happen, and it'll be something completely left field and out of nowhere, you know. And I feel like a lot of wrestling fans and a lot of wrestlers book wrestling to be like unpredictable, and unpredictable is good, don't get me wrong, like you want to throw a spanner in the works sometimes, but I feel like if everything's unpredictable, everything's the same. So like with the story I did with Zach before he turned heel, like it was predictable, but I feel like we did a good enough job of telling it that it was still really satisfying. So we teased it a couple of times with Zach turning heel, and basically Zach's whole year was leading up to the point where there was no other option but for him to turn heel. It was just a case of, when is he going to turn heel? So we wrote the losing streak, so he didn't win a match. Basically he lost his, I can't remember if it was second or third round match in the tournament, he lost a match against Luke Aldridge. And we'd set the finish up so that he was going to lose via Luke cheating some way. I think he did the feet on the ropes. And it just happened that the following month, I was in the next round match with Luke. So we decided to do a thing where Luke would do the feet on the ropes, as if he was going to, I think he did it to begin with on the first round. We did it with Zach in the second round, and then we did the same finish with me, but I was going to be wise to it and kick out of it or find a way out of it. And the actual finish of that match was a little bit different. We did a finish where I didn't win clean. I think I had the look on my shoulders. He was fighting off. We stepped back and he fell behind me, but he kind of crotched himself on the ropes. I didn't realize it, took advantage of it and got the win. I thought it was a clean victory. Zach Leon thought differently and he was like, oh, you've won by cheating kind of thing. And we did a thing where Zach would go on a losing streak, and every single time he lost, he would lose by cheating. So he wanted to plant that seed that eventually Zach was going to, you know, snap with it, you know. And I feel like we did a good dynamic because we had the two of us being allies, me being the champion at the time, and he was on this, like, I was winning all these matches, I was carrying the belt, and I was winning cleanly in every single match, whereas Zach was kind of playing second fiddle in my shadow. He was losing every single match, and not only was he losing, he was getting cheated out of a win every single match. So like we did a full year almost of planting that seed where Zach was getting more and more and more and more frustrated, to the point where we obviously got to that crescendo in the match in at Hell for Lycra, where he eventually turned heel on me. And like I much prefer that kind of thing rather than moments. Like, don't get me wrong, moments are great. Obviously, like when I came back from Australia, that moment was fantastic. And I don't think I'll have a moment in wrestling that will top that. But I feel like if you were following that story from start to finish, there was enough nuance in there that you saw it coming, but it was one of those kind of ones where when it happened, you went, I called it. I knew that was going to happen. And I feel like it's in with that kind of storyline, if it is predictable in that kind of way, you can almost get the fans to relate even more because, you know, the fans feel like they're in on it, you know? Whereas if I had Zach turn heel at the start of the year, it would be completely out of nowhere. It'd be completely random. And then you'd have to justify it afterwards. I feel like a lot of wrestling storylines, especially in like WWE especially, are all about those moments where stuff happens and then you spend the next few weeks or next few months trying to explain what happened. And there's nothing wrong with explaining how to get to a point and having that point happen afterwards, you know?
Oh yeah, I mean, like I say, I'm in total agreement with that. When that's what I mean by moments is having that lead up to it, because one of my favorite moments from WrestleZone, because the one I go to the most, was the breakup of their biggest faction. And they asked me to do a big write-up about it, and then when I kept going back, I was like, this started 18 months ago.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
there was just points where you're going, this is how it all led to that moment, and that's why that moment was the best, because I had 18 months of work behind it. That's what I mean by my I love moments, because it has to have some logic behind it. You're right, with WWE, it's a case of, oh, they've turned heel, right, they're going to take the next 3 weeks, try to retroactively make sense of it all.
And then they'll probably turn on babyface again. Yeah, whatever happened.
And then, well, fans on Reddit especially, they're the worst for that. It's a case of, oh, he's so cool, now he's a heel, I'm going to cheer him. That's not the point of being a heel. Being a heel is you boo them. So boo them.
That's one of my biggest bugbears. And it's probably the reason why I don't really ever want to be heel, because I don't want to be a cool heel, you know? I'm probably one of the few people in Scotland who's worked babyface their entire career. I think I worked maybe one match as a heel back when I worked Reckless. I had a match against Delson Dare. And that's the only time I've ever worked heel in my entire career. Every other match I've worked babyface. But at the same time, like I actually had this conversation a couple of days ago with Zach and Kevin Williams, actually. How one of my biggest bugbears in wrestling is that everything's black and white. Like, there's no gray areas. Like, you're either a heel or you're a babyface. Like, I feel like I said this to the guys. Like, if you've got a babyface who is perfect in every single way, there's no flaws to their character. Therefore, there's no flaws for them to overcome. Therefore, there's no character development. And if there's no character development, then how the hell are you going to get over, you know? And that, I think that's the reason why baby faces have such a difficult time getting over with the crowd, because wrestling to a lot of people is so black and white that it's like, okay, you're a heel, therefore everything you have to do has to be heelish. You know, you can't do a good thing as a heel because you're a heel. Similarly, if you're a baby face, you can't do a bad thing as a baby face because you're a baby face. You're meant to get cheered. But I don't know. I feel like if you have a bit more gray area there, where if you have a character flaw and can work that into your character and can work that into your story, I think that helped. That's what will help the baby faces get over, because people will relate to those flaws. And if you work to overcome those flaws, that's when people will start getting behind you and, you know, supporting you to try and get over that. I feel like there's too many wrestling fans and too many wrestling shows that I think WWE is a big part of the problem there. It's part of the reason why I've never really watched WWE or really cared for it, is that, you know, like, baby faces on the main roster shows just look like idiots all the time. Like, there's too many times where the heel will, you know, outsmart the baby face, and the baby face could easily see it coming, but they don't, because they need to work from under. You know, that's the standard thing of the baby face being the underdog. But you know, if you're not smart about it, you just look like an idiot. And if you look like an idiot, no one's going to care about you.
Absolutely. I think one of the best faces at the moment in WWE is Kevin Owens for that exact thing you're on about. He's not clean cut babyface, yeah. But he's quite happy to go, you're being a bit of a knob here. I'm gonna sort you out, but I'm gonna do it my way kind of thing. And anyway, if we start speaking about WWE, we're gonna end up in a round circle. We'll be agreeing, but we'll be adding layers onto the same exact point. Right, we'll go to the questions then. Zach Leone asked, who is your favorite wrestling friend and why is it him?
Well, he's just answered his own question, you know. Yeah, to be honest with you, like I consider, like, since I came back from Australia, Zach has been my go-to guy. Like, if I've got any questions, any ideas, any thoughts about absolutely anything, even if it's not wrestling related, Zach's been my go-to guy. Like, as much as I said, like, JD's like my other half in wrestling. Like, if I look at it in sort of a relationship kind of terms, like, me and JD are like a long-term couple who have been together for years and years and years. You know, we know each other and trust each other enough to know all of our own problems and how to fix them. I don't really need to go to JD very much with anything, because I know exactly what he's going to say, and I know exactly, like, we have a very close, almost symbiotic relationship. But I'd say JD's my other half, whereas Zach's definitely like my best friend in wrestling. There's certainly no one
on the side.
Yeah, I've got on the side. there's definitely no one I probably confide in as much as I do Zach these days. Although, like, I don't want to say that in a discredit against a lot of people. There is quite a few guys that I put a lot of trust in. Mighty Fine Eddie Devine is another one who have a lot of time for, and we've both gone to each other about our own issues and helped each other through some tough times. So, but Zach's definitely the guy on the top. Not to say I'm the bottom in that relationship.
Yeah, I could have went all sorts of wrong. His actual question is, what would your last match be, where and who with, if you had to do anything you wanted, no limits?
I mean, realistically, I'd probably say JD. I feel like it's like you said earlier about how it was poetic for me to have the next match against Tommy. I feel like there's no one else I could have a final match with apart from JD. Like, even everyone else I've had kind of feuds with, like obviously Zach Leon, although we never got the feud we wanted towards the end of it. Obviously, we got the heel turn, and we did a couple of matches after that. And our last match, where he won the title off me, is another one of my favorite matches. But like I say, the relationship's nothing compared to my relationship with JD. It's just very different, and I feel like it needs to be JD. I mean, if we're talking anybody in wrestling whatsoever, I'm trying to think who I would love a match with. I mean, if there's any wrestler still active today that I would have a match with, he would absolutely murder me, but I would love a match with Minoru Suzuki.
Okay. The Ardler Complex or anywhere in particular?
I mean, that if it was Suzuki, it definitely wouldn't be the Ardler Complex. As much as I called that place home for a long time. If it was JD, then definitely Ardler Complex, because that's where we had most of our matches. If it was Minoru Suzuki, I'd probably say either Korakuen Hall or Osaka Joe Hall. That would be the ideal.
Absolutely. I mean, is Japanese wrestling a big favorite of yours? I mean, Ring of Honor, I'm assuming it is, because of Ring of Honor. Yeah. You're fan of technical masterpieces as opposed to main event wrestling, as you put it, which is a great way to put it when I'm thinking about that. Okay, so we've got Omar Mohammed. He asked, how's your jaw?
Still a little sore. For those who haven't seen the match, we had a match a couple of years ago, back when I was Future Division champion, and he pretty much dislocated it for a couple of weeks. And he has apologized several times since then, but I don't know if he means it that much. I would quite like to dislocate his one day, but no, I've actually always see this is probably a problem I've had because I was never a sporty or active person growing up. My body's not that great. Like, I have real issues with my wrists, and I think I've always had issues with my jaw. So I consider myself to be a bit of a glass jaw, and Omar kicking me square in it when he should have hit me in the stomach. I don't know how he managed to miss by that much of a margin. Yeah, that didn't do it very much. That did it very much good. That was a fun match. Actually, it's probably the only match I've ever had where I thought I was legitimately coming out of it with a concussion, but I think I'm fine.
That's right. I'm sure you're all right. We've got Rain asking, do you remember winning match of the year, which I was cheated out of a win because you were the legal man?
So that the match she's referring to there is actually the very first match she had in Dundee, which was against, it was actually myself and Holly Dead versus Rain and Prince Assad. I'm assuming she has actually spoken to me about this before. I think if you look back on the footage, I think I was a legal man. Therefore, Holy Dead pinning Rain was illegitimate. But I actually haven't watched the match back recently to tell if that's true or not. I'll have to watch that back. That was a fantastic match. That's another match where I actually did nothing in the match. Like, it was all Holy Dead. But it was so much fun.
I'm sensing a pattern. It's like some of your favorite matches, once you do nothing in.
Well, like, because I do nothing in them, they give me a good chance to sit back and enjoy the rest of them. You know, if I'm standing on the apron, I get to enjoy Holiday's work. She's another person. The charisma on her is off the charts. Like, she's such an intimidating person, but such a lovely person at the same time. Like, I would not want to get on the wrong side of her.
And the final question I got in was from Alan Johnson. He asked, favourite and least favourite levels of Fall Guys?
I've actually not played Fall Guys since Season 2 dropped. My favourite level is probably Seesaw, which is a very controversial one, purely because I'm really good at it, so I can get up front really quickly. And I just get to enjoy, them being the masochist I am, I get to enjoy watching everyone fail. Try and get to the end of it for the next 20 minutes. Least favorite level is still by far the soccer one. I can't remember what it's called now. Fall ball, I think it's called. That just needs to get in the bin. That's a horrible level.
I thought you looked at me for a second thinking I would know. I've not played fall ball. So I'm just like, don't ask me.
I recommend it. I recommend it. It's actually a really good game. I just haven't had a chance to play it.
For what I was aware of, I don't have PlayStation Plus. I just have the free PSN. Okay, yeah. So as far as I was aware, it's all, you have to have PlayStation Plus to play it. I'm like, I may pay £15 for it to do that.
Yeah, it's all multiplayer, so
I know that means I actually have to start speaking to people. I don't want to do that either. I'm quite happy. I'm playing Psychonauts at the moment. I downloaded that.
Oh, nice one. Yeah.
Because
I never beat it, but I've played it.
Oh, I've gone through a little bit of a run at the moment. It's like, I want to play Spyro, but I don't want to play Spyro. So I want to play games that are like Spyro. So I played Ratchet and Clank. And now I'm playing Psychonauts, so that's where we are at that moment.
See, I have a huge issue where I have a lot of games. Like, you can see behind me, I've got a bunch of games. I've got more off screen, and I've got literally hundreds of PlayStation 4 games on my account that I've got digitally. But I'm one of these people that I spend a lot of money on games, and then I just don't play them. Like, out of all the games I have, I've maybe completed about 5% of them. I'm someone who plays a game and then I'll buy another game, and because I've bought a new game, I end up playing that and then ignoring the last game, and then 5 days after that I'll maybe buy a new game and then completely ignore the game before it. And it's just a vicious cycle that I need to get out of. But I just love the rush of buying a new game. For some reason, that seems to make me happy. Not actually playing them, just buying them and having them.
I'm in the same boat. It's like, well, especially during lockdown, I go in the PlayStation store and go, oh, it's down from £40 to £5. Oh, yeah, buy that. Yeah. And that's I load it up and go, what else have I got? I'll just play that. I would Just Cause 3 that's just sitting, never played. Because I loaded it up and went, ugh, nah, it's fine.
I've got a weird kind of situation as well where because I've started a Twitch account and I stream intermittently, I'll get a game and I'll maybe be really in the mood to play a game. And then I'll go, nah, I want to save that for Twitch, knowing that I'll probably never actually play it on Twitch. So although I really want to play it, I'll just never get around to it because I won't play it unless I'm streaming, which I don't do enough to be able to justify that.
Well, I was going to ask you that just before we wrapped up then. We'll do the last of the wrestling questions, I suppose. So when the shows come back, where do you want to go? Is there any companies that you have visited yet that you want to wrestle for in front of their crowd or anything like that?
Yeah, so obviously the match announcement's already been made for Fair City Wrestling, so that'll likely be the very, very first show back that I'm on, at least. Other than that, like, obviously had a little bit of time with Source before lockdown. So I still want to be part of that when we're all back to wrestling again. I would love to go to basically all other promotions in Scotland. Like, WrestleZone's always been a promotion that I really want to go up to, but because it's in Aberdeen, it's just somewhere that I've never had the time to. I'd love to go back down to Reckless. There's a lot of guys in Reckless at the moment who I have a lot of time for. A lot of guys in Reckless that I used to see fairly often when they were wrestling Dundee that I've not seen in a long time. And probably the big one is Discovery. I think anyone in Scottish wrestling should want to go to Discovery, I think. It's probably one of the most, in terms of like, when you consider how long it's been a promotion, it's probably done the best, I would say, out of cementing itself as like a top tier promotion in the shortest amount of time. You know, I would definitely prefer to go to Discovery than ICW or anything like that these days. I mean, if I'm completely honest, I've never really had any desire to wrestle for ICW. It's just not really my kind of thing. As I said earlier, like I'm don't get, obviously ICW has all sorts of different wrestling styles on its show, and I've seen some fantastic technical matches through ICW, but its overall presentation, it's not my kind of cup of tea. That said, I was about to say the reason for that is because when you look at the word sports entertainment, I tend to prefer the sports aspect of it rather than the entertainment side of things. That's obviously applicable to any promotion. Like, most promotions in Scotland are focused more on the entertainment side of things. But yeah, in terms of ICW's more adult style, I prefer working the families. The families are always where you get the most satisfaction out of. Don't get me wrong, like, I obviously worked a lot of over 18 shows in Dundee, and they've always been fun, but they're nothing compared to working a more family friendly show. Which is weird that I say that, because I've never really had an awful lot of time for kids outside of wrestling. Like, I don't have any kids of my own. I've no real intention of ever having them. And if you put a baby in my hands, I really have no idea what to do with it. But yeah, there's no bigger satisfaction than, you know, making the kids happy when you're working these shows. You know, if you've got guys wanting, they've actually got their hand out after your match to slap hands afterwards, then you're doing a good job.
It's a nice way to round up. So where can people find you on social media then? Well, what are you doing on Twitch? Tell us all. This is going to go out around about the start of March, so I don't know what you'll be doing then, but what's your general
probably
Twitch
not much different
stuff?
So I have an account on pretty much everything social wise. Facebook, I think it's just facebook.com/KenKaiden. I don't really use it that much anymore, to be honest with you though. Instagram, I'm a little bit more active, but not really recently. That's just Instagram, or at ken.kaiden. I'm mostly more social on Twitter and Twitch these days, which is both, or twitch.tv/KenKaiden or at Ken Kaiden on Twitter. Yeah, those two places are where you'll find me. If you want to follow me on Twitch, please do. I would love a few more followers on that. I mostly just play a lot of single player games, a lot of Rocket League if anyone's into that, and I've got the PS2 hooked up as well, so I try and play a lot of PS2 era games as well. So if anyone's listening fancies a wee trip down memory lane to the early 2000s, which is probably what I consider the golden era of gaming for me, give me a wee follow on Twitch. That'd be great.
Excellent. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me today, and this has went a lot longer than I probably thought. I don't remember where we started, but here we are, just under another 2-hour episode again of the SWN podcast. But yeah, again, thank you very much for chatting with me today. So it's no gimmicks needed, Ken Kaiden.
No gimmicks at all. Straight shooting.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
All right. Take care.